Good evening. Certainly a joy to be with everybody tonight. Certainly a joy that everybody came back out tonight. We're having a biblical question and answer night tonight, and this is very exciting. And I'll just go ahead and jump right into it. My question is a very interesting question. There's many different ways I could go with it, many different approaches, but I'll try to keep my time down here. So let's first look at what's the question. What is the question in the way it was asked to me? Well, this is the way it was asked. Genesis 7, flood worldwide or only in occupied world? That was the question. So was the flood a universal flood or was it a local flood? Well, before I can answer that, we need to go back. First of all, why was there a flood? Why was there a flood in the first place? Context, context, context is key. So we go back to Genesis 6th chapter, and in Genesis 6th chapter, verses 11 through 14, it says, "Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight." That's all that ever matters. If God says something, well, then it's true. In God's eyes, in God's sight, the earth is corrupt. And the earth was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, this is key, "I have determined to make an end of all flesh, for the earth is filled with violence through them. Behold, I will destroy them with the earth." Make yourself an ark of gopher wood. I don't know how well you can see it up there, but I've underlined certain things. He's going to make an end, all flesh, and destroy them in the earth. There's certain things that we have to look at here. But before we get into chapter 7, where the actual flood takes place, we need to note some things. In chapter 7, verses 21 through 23, we have the extent of the destruction of the flood. All flesh, we need to notice that, all flesh is going to perish. All in whose nostrils was the breath of life. Now this does not include fish. And then chapter 7, verse 24, the water prevailed. We're mighty conquered, Young's literal translation says. Those things are key. Those things are important to note as we now look at chapter 7. This is the extent of the destruction of the flood. Genesis 7, which was where the question was asked from, let's begin here in verses 21. And notice, all flesh died that moved on the earth, birds, livestock, beasts, and all swarming creatures that swarm on the earth, and all mankind, everything on the dry land, and whose nostrils was the breath of life, died on dry land. Notice that. He blotted out every living thing that was on the face of the ground, man and animals and creeping things and birds of the heavens. They were blotted out from the earth. Only Noah was left and those who were with him in the ark. And the waters prevailed on the earth 150 days. So now we have looked at two instances in Scripture about the flood. And again, there's still things to note, certain key words, certain things. All died. Look at that. I underlined those words there. All died on earth. Just something that I thought I'd point out there. Certain words we can underline. But here's my answer to this question. So was the flood, was it a local flood, just happened in a certain place, or was it universal? Well, the flood was too high and too long not to be universal. Genesis 7th chapter, verses 19 through 20. Of course, now that's not substantial evidence. That is my answer, but you need probably a little bit more. Why would Noah need to build an ark if it was a local flood? If it happened in a certain area and it wasn't across the whole world, why would Noah need to build an ark if it was just a local flood? If it was a local flood, he could have been far away. He could have traveled far distance in 100 years. He could have traveled far away. So why would Noah need to build an ark is the proposition, the argument I make. And also, so could anyone else. If it was a local flood, just in a certain area, anyone could have gone away multiple miles away and been quote-unquote safe if it was just a local flood in a certain area. But again, I need to give you some more. So if it was local, what about in 2 Peter? In 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter, verses 10 through 12, "But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hasting the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn?" Okay, but then what about 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5? "If He," meaning God, "if God did not spare the ancient world, but preserved Noah, a herald of righteousness, with 7 others, when he brought a flood upon the world of the ungodly." And then, of course, lastly, I'd like to look at Luke. Luke says that all men were destroyed. Everything was destroyed. If we look in Luke, the 17th chapter, verse 27, we have our answer. "They were eating and drinking and marrying and being given in marriage until the day when Noah entered the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all." So there's my things, and I'm up to 7 minutes here now, but there's my thoughts. So if anyone has any further questions or need further clarification, feel free to ask one of us. Thank you.
I think the centennial really messed us up a little bit in trying to do keep regular question and answer nights going on. We did manage to get one in July, and we're getting one in November after the centennial, and I've got one scheduled for Groundhog Day, February 2nd, so that'll be interesting. But I think these are useful nights, and so we had 5 questions submitted. Aidan took one, I'm taking the middle 3, and then Jim Shuman will do the last one here. And I've never done these before I came here, and so this is an interesting format. I really enjoy it and like it, but as a preacher, I tend to want to explain and expound, and it's hard because you're trying to contain. I could go on one question for the next, 20-25 minutes, and that's probably not the best thing to do. So what I have done is I've set between 5 and 7 minutes for each of the 3 questions. And so I've got 21 minutes on my timer here. So when you hear that go off, you know that I should be at the end of the 3rd question. We'll see how that goes. But it's a night to stump the preacher, intern, and elder with what's been on your mind. And I think stump the preacher, intern, and elder is a good name for the game here a little bit. I do appreciate having those at least a week ahead of time so we can look at some of these questions and answers. But 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly handling the word of truth." And so we are people of the word. We need to be looking for our answers within the pages of Scripture. So I think that's a very good thing. And we ought to be able to say, "Thus saith the Lord," for whatever it is that we are teaching or preaching up here. And so I think that's a really good thing. Okay, I'm going to start the timer. I was given 3 different questions, and again, just as Aidan did, I'm putting the question just as it was written on the paper, and then we'll take a look at the answer there. Who are his saints? And I've covered this in a couple of different classes as to what saints are, but in particular, this person put 2 different scripture references there, and so that makes it very interesting as to the context of where these saints appear. So in 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, we see, now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus direct our way to you, and may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. So at that time, we see that when Jesus comes, returns to us, that he never sets foot on earth again. We see that in the next chapter. But he will have with all his saints, that Jesus is going to be coming and he'll have all of his saints with him. So we do look at the next chapter in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and we can see who God is meaning by these saints that are here. It says, for since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. So those who have died in the Lord, they've obeyed the gospel, they live faithfully, and Jesus will bring them with him, it says, those who have fallen asleep. But then there are saints who are here on earth as well, those who have obeyed the gospel and have been living faithfully. What happens with them? It says, for this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them. With who? With Jesus and those saints who have fallen asleep in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we, which would mean all of us, those who are dead in Christ and those who are alive at his coming, will always be with the Lord. And so we need to look in particular at that word saint to try to understand biblically what God is speaking about when we see that word in Scripture. A lot of times in the denominational world, a saint is somebody who is a special class of Christian in some ways. You've got your regular Christians, and they're just living their lives and doing whatever they want to do. And then the saints are those who go above and beyond and who are extra holy in some ways. But that's not a biblical view of the word saint. The way in which God uses the word saint is to indicate holy one. So the word there, hagioi, or hagios in the singular, it's a noun. Vine's expository dictionary says it's those who are holy. Holy is a word that's used only for God, and by extension, those who are in Christ are able to be holy, blameless before God. So it's used of believers, as in all believers as well. Not a particular class of believers, but all believers are set apart to be holy or sanctified is another way that we see that. The word saint comes from that same root word as sanctified, set apart for a particular purpose for God. The other passage that they mentioned in that question was Jude 1, verse 14. It was also about these that Enoch, the seventh from Adam, and you can see about Enoch in Genesis chapter 5 there, prophesied saying, behold, the Lord comes with 10,000s of his holy ones. What's interesting about that is that in Genesis, we don't see any quote from Enoch. And so this is something that the Holy Spirit must have revealed in later times or is carried down through history as a prophecy from Enoch that is being used here in the book of Jude. But the Lord comes with 10,000s of his holy ones. Well, we just read about that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. There's the holy ones that are with God. And so Enoch, we see in Genesis 5, verse 24, he walked with God. Hebrews 11, verse 5 tells us that he never experienced death, that God had just taken him to be with him, and he was no more, it says there. Philippians chapter 1 and verse 1 gives us an idea that saint does indicate everybody who's obeyed the gospel and is within a church. It says in Philippians 1:1, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints or holy ones in Christ Jesus who are at Philippi with the overseers and deacons. And so we see that everybody who's in Christ is indeed a saint. The second question here, I'm at 15:26, so I'm doing pretty well out of 21 minutes. So the second question is guardian angels, just for the young, Matthew 18 and verse 10. At first this question kind of jumped out at me. I'm like, well, I'm not sure what the person's getting at here. When I was a little boy growing up in the Catholic Church, obviously we believed in guardian angels. That was something that was part that was taught in Sunday school classes and everything else. But as I become an adult and a Christian, I've not looked at seen that in Scripture at all, where there's a particular class of guardian angels. So let's back up and look at what the word angel means. It comes from angelos in the Greek, which means messenger. And so even Angela comes from this word. She's my angel. She's probably not my messenger. I shouldn't say, oh, well, there's my wonderful messenger. The one who is sent, basically, is an angel. And so that's what that means. And so we get the word evangelist also from that. EU as a prefix means good in Greek, and angelistes means messenger. So a good messenger is an evangelist. He has the good news that he brings forth. And so I think that's important to understand as we jump into an understanding of angels. Angels may guard. We can see in Genesis 3 and verse 24 that God placed a cherubim with a flaming sword to keep mankind from the Garden of Eden, right? And so he's guarding, it says there. That word is being used there in Genesis 3:24. But they're never called guardian angels in Scripture, but probably just folklore. So where might we get this idea? Hebrews 1 and verse 14 says, "Are they," meaning angels, "are not all ministering spirits sent out to serve for the sake of those who are to inherit salvation?" So God uses angels in a certain way for us, to minister to us, to help us. And I don't know in what form or shape that takes place, but we can make some guesses there of how God might use them to minister to us and help us. We do have an example of Jesus being ministered to by angels. This is in Matthew chapter 4, verse 11. After he has been tempted in the desert, he's fasted for 40 days, and Satan has come to him, and there's been three different temptations that are recorded there. And after Jesus makes it through all three of those temptations, Matthew's account says, "Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and were ministering to him." So we can see that God was using angels for his son, who was fully man, just as we are, yet was without sin, in the same way that he probably allows angels to minister to us. And so here's the main text that they were asking about in Matthew chapter 18, but I want to back up a little bit, because here it says, "At that time the disciples came to Jesus saying, 'Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?'" Now, Jesus is a master teacher. He uses illustrations all the time. There's a little child there, so he calls the little child over. He puts him in the midst of them and said, "Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." The focus is not on the child. The focus is on the disciples who are wondering who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. The child's just being used as an illustration of comparison to say you need to become like children or you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. After that, Jesus uses the phrase little ones, little ones, little ones, over and over again in the verses that follow, verses 4 through 9, that refers to the disciples being like children. And then by the time we get to verse 10, it says here, "See that you do not despise one of these little ones," meaning the disciples, "for I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven." This is very confusing often because we think that this refers to children. But if you look at Luke's account, we can see in Luke chapter 17 that there's not even a child in that a description there of what goes on. Jesus never brings a child over to illustrate that we need to become like children. But he said to his disciples, "Temptations to sin are sure to come, but woe to the one through whom they come. It would be better for him if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea than that he should cause one of these little ones to sin. Jesus still refers to disciples there without a child being present in Luke chapter 17. So it's very evident in Luke's account that we're not talking about children here. We're talking about disciples. And so Jesus is referring to the, if we go back to that phrase there in Matthew 18:10, "For I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven." Does that mean that these angels are personally assigned, like a guardian angel might be, that we understand in our culture that guardian angels do, that everybody has, you know, mine is Jehoshaphat, you know, I named him that, and this is my personal, like Harvey the rabbit, that goes around with me and keeps me safe, or does God maybe use a variety of angels working with us in various situations? I don't know if they take shifts. Or maybe each person who becomes a Christian has an angel or two as a ministering angel to us. I don't know exactly how that works. But if we go back to Acts chapter 12 and verse 14 and 15, this is the story of Peter who has been arrested after James has been put to death by the sword at the beginning of that chapter. And the angel lets Peter out of prison. And he finds himself heading through the city, and he gets to the door of John Mark's mother, where the disciples are all there. The church is praying for his release. And poor Rhoda, she goes to the door, and Peter is knocking. And it says there, "Recognizing Peter's voice in her joy, she ran in and reported that Peter was standing at the gate." Keep in mind, she hasn't seen him yet. She's only heard his voice. "They said to her, 'You are out of your mind,' but she kept insisting that it was so, and they kept saying, 'It is his angel.'" That's an interesting thing there, that, you know, they're not saying, well, he must have been killed and it's probably his ghost at the door. I don't think it's that. I think they're recognizing in the understanding of how God uses angels to minister to those who will inherit salvation that Peter, his angel is at the door because they don't understand that God could have allowed Peter to escape somehow and come back to them. So there's that question there. And now I'm on the third one, and I've got 742 left on the thing here. Degrees of rewards and punishment. And this one's a little bit tougher to answer because look at all those passages of scripture that we have there. So I want to start out with a passage that's not there, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, 7 through 9, because there are only two classes of people. There are saved people and lost people. And so when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus, they will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. So we can see that those who do not know God, do not obey the gospel, that they are eternally separated from God in a state of eternal destruction. So there's those who are saved on that narrow road, as we talked this morning, and those who are on that broad road that are facing eternal destruction. Now, within being saved or being finding punishment, is there varying degrees? Dante's Inferno, if you've ever read that, I don't know, where's my fellow English teacher back there? She's shaking her head. Okay. Dante's Inferno, and of course there's Paradiso as well. We can see that there are different levels of heaven and hell, but that's a work of fiction. And I think Dante liked to put a lot of his political enemies in the different levels of hell. If you read that, and I have read it, it was hard reading there because a lot of history and so forth. But the Bible speaks about a sovereign God's judgment. That there's those who will be saved and those who will be lost. And within the saved, there are perhaps varying degrees of what God will do. He's sovereign. He's able to give us various rewards because it's his choice. And those who are being punished, it's a sovereign God's choice to be able to do what he will there. So what does Scripture say about this? 2 Peter 2, "For if they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ," and so these are ones who have obeyed the gospel, "they are again entangled in them and overcome. The last state has become worse for them than the first, for it would have been better for them never to have known the way of righteousness than after knowing it to turn back from the holy commandment delivered to them." And so we can see that it sounds like judgment's not going to go well for those who had obeyed the gospel and were once in a saved state, but now God is finding judgment and putting judgment there upon them. And it sounds like it'll be worse for them than if they had never known God. If they had never known God, it would have been eternal destruction shut away from the presence of the Lord. But having known the way of righteousness and turned away is somehow worse. Matthew 23:14, and this is a variant in your Bibles. If you have a Bible there and you want to look, it may not have it. It may be in a footnote down at the bottom there if you want to check your Bibles. But it says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you devour widows' houses, and for a pretense you make long prayers. Therefore you will receive the greater condemnation." Well, scribes and Pharisees were outside of the new covenant with Christ that was made through his work on the cross and at the tomb. They were part of the Old Testament God's people, but they were supposed to be religious leaders. And so they're not doing what their office should allow them to do, and so it might go worse for them there in their punishment. Hebrews chapter 10, "How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has spurned the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified?" So that's telling us that this person was in a saved state at some point, that he had obeyed the gospel, and instead of living faithfully, he has spurned the Son of God, profaning the blood of the covenant, has outraged the spirit of grace, for we know him who said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay, and again the Lord will judge his people." Oh, what a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Judgment will not be great for those who have known the way of righteousness and then turn away from it. 1 Corinthians chapter 3:13, "Each one's work will become manifest." He's speaking to the Christians at Corinth here, Paul is. "Each one's work will become manifest, for the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test what sort of work each one has done." And so that's expected at judgment. Each of us has to stand before God and give an account of his life. And the work that we do as Christians, as we live our lives before God, it's going to be put through the test of fire, that the true nature of our work, was it spiritually minded for eternity's sake, our treasure stored in heaven, or was our treasure stored on earth where moth and rust could destroy, and it was of a temporary nature and will be burned away. And so that's speaking of judgment, a sovereign God's judgment for those who have obeyed the gospel, to see how it is that we will live one day. Luke chapter 12, and I'm down to a minute 54. I'm doing well here. "And that servant who knew his master's will, but did not get ready or act according to his will receive a severe beating." So notice here in this parable, this passage that was mentioned here, it says the servant who knew his master's will. So who are the servants? The servants would be those who have obeyed the gospel, who are living their life in Christ, and they knew their master's will. They had the word of God available to them. They'd heard it preached. They heard it taught in classes. They've been living it out, or should have been, perhaps their own personal Bible study and prayer time. They knew their master's will, but did not get ready or act according to his will, receive a severe beating. There's the punishment. "But the one who did not know," so this is a person who had no idea what he was supposed to do. He's still a servant, but did what deserved a beating, will receive a light beating. So it sounds like God does have a different set of standards there, but God's the one who decides that, not us, about what happens. "Everyone to whom much was given, of him much will be required. And there's that last verse, chapter 3 and verse 1 of James. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. If more is given to us, more is expected of us, more is required. And from him to whom they entrusted much, they will demand the more. And so there we can see how it is, as best as we can understand, with God being the sovereign judge and us being the ones who are supposed to obey and live according to his word and not our own work and will. That is the end. And I think elders, they could preach to midnight, right? Yeah.
Final question was presented to us. And they gave it to me because it had very few biblical verses to have to go through, right? Because the question was, what did Jesus look like? And it's been on man's mind ever since the last person that saw Jesus passed away. You know, I think the next generation was, what did Grandpa say that Jesus looked like, type thing, and carried on. Because there is nothing in the Bible that describes his physical appearance in the New Testament, and the only thing that's even close was part of the question that whoever asked that question had put in, Isaiah 53, verses 2 and 3, which said, he has no form, no glory, nor beauty when we beheld him, but his appearance was without honor and inferior to that of the sons of men. So, I think we can look at all the pictures, and I could go through and put 20, 30 different artists' renditions of what Jesus looked like in their minds. And the one that always pops up seems to be the romance novel, long-haired guy, right? Again, we're talking, I'm not making fun of the ideas, right? Because everybody has to have their imaginations. And in fact, Augustine, one of the early church fathers, saw said perhaps everyone saw Jesus differing depending on their own spiritual response to him. Augustine suggested that everyone has a different image of Jesus. It depends on where you're from, what you imagine, what you consider normal, type thing. He wrote, the physical face of the Lord is pictured with infinite variety by the countless imaginations. Though whatever it was like, he certainly had one. You know. So we know he had a face. We know he had a physical form. What it looked like, we have no cotton. Yeah. We don't have images and pictures of a lot of the first century Jews because that was a graven image. And Jews didn't paint pictures of each other, right? But I'm pretty sure he wasn't blonde. And I'm pretty sure he wasn't blue-eyed because where was he from? Judea? Northern Israel? Okay, so a lot of that look, those pictures all came after, at the end of the Roman Empire, more of a Greek influence from the Greek gods or from the early Europeans. And you think of all the Crusades and everything else, what were those people from England looking like and that were coming down for the Crusades? So what were their artists drawing from? You know, what's this guy look like? Who's our king look like? They're trying to make him look glorious as a king of the Jews, king of the world. But depending on that, one of the writers said that more than likely the different images of Jesus is more a reflection on the painter or the artist than it was on Jesus. The one thing Augustine did add to his comment about all those different images was not regarding our faith, or nor as regards in our faith that we have in Lord Jesus Christ, It is the least relevant to our salvation, what our imaginations picture him as. What he looked like really doesn't matter. Because what did God tell Samuel when he went to anoint the first king, or the king to replace Saul, when they went to anoint David? Remember, the brothers came down and Samuel looked at the biggest one and said, "That's got to be the one." And what did God say? "Neither has the Lord chosen this one. Do not look at his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as a man sees. A man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." And if we do that with Jesus, what was Jesus' heart look like? That's what's important. That's where we need to focus our attentions. But then when David was anointed, they sent him in, and David appeared before Samuel, and it says, "Now he was a ruddy, had beautiful eyes, and was handsome." So God didn't pick David because he didn't look good. You know, he had that appearance. But we don't pick Jesus because we think he looks good. Which of these look more like Jesus to you? I know it's never been mentioned that Jesus was a Nazarite that could not cut his hair, right? He was never under a Nazarite vow. There was one meme I could not find when I needed to put in here, but it showed a picture of, similar to this one on the right, that said, if Jesus looked like this, how many American Christians would be willing to sit beside him on an airplane? Do our prejudices keep us from accepting Jesus looking like a Jew? You know, if you think of what that region looks like today, even. So that's our biggest thing. But we know Jesus as a boy, when he was young, when they took him to the temple to after they were in Egypt, they went to Jerusalem. Luke 2:40 says, "He grew and became strong and filled with wisdom and favor with God, and the favor of God was with him." And then when he was 12, he went to the temple. And after that incident, it said, "And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man." So I don't accept the pictures of the weakling little Jesus that's always, you know, looks like he's so frail he's going to get blown over. That doesn't look like a man. It was a carpenter's son. You know, and this wasn't a woodworking shop like you all are used to now with all the power tools. This was taking logs and hewing them out with an axe and everything else and hauling it around. Or a man that could go out and walk 30 miles to get to someplace. So it's all in our imaginations what the physical appearance looks like. But the physical appearance isn't what's important. What is important is, are we ready to see what he looks like when he comes again? We're going to see him face to face. Are we ready to accept the Jesus that returns? And are we going to be ready for him to accept us? That's our important. So at this time, I'd like to go ahead and offer an invitation. If you're not ready for Jesus to come back tonight, get your heart prepared. If you need to come forward and ask for help and for prayers, if you've never accepted Jesus, come forward and let's get this taken care of. We extend that invitation at this time.